Okay, good morning and welcome back. Seems like a long time, but time is a strange experience these days. It does seem to be going faster. Today is episode 21, Reading Chuangzi, and it is Wednesday, July 28, and quite hot here in Taiwan. So, on the basis of my sort of disinterest reading additional chapters, what's called the outer chapters and the miscellaneous chapters of Zhuangzi. The inner chapters are 1 through 7, and then 8 through 33, or whatever the total is, 32, are called outer or miscellaneous chapters. And what I want to do today is, as much as possible, read simply the foreword to a translation of a Chinese fellow's analysis of Zhuangzi. So the original analysis is from a guy named Liu Xiaogan, and he wrote a book called Classifying the Zhuangzi Chapters. And the translation of a first part of that by somebody named William Savage, William E. Savage, is in the PDF that I'm referring to today from the Michigan Center for Chinese Studies at University of Michigan, Ann Arbor, which has been in play. They've been since 1968. And actually, my stepsister went to University of Michigan and studied Chinese there decades ago. And so this is a document from their department, Center of Chinese Studies, Michigan, translated by William Savage, written by Liu Xiaogan, with a foreword by William or Donald Monroe, And it's simply portions of that foreword that I want to read out and comment on, which basically has the ultimate conclusion that yes, indeed, not only Liu Xiaogan in his analysis of the chapters, but another man named Angus Graham, both came to similar conclusions that, yes, indeed, based on very tight scholarly analysis of the characters, of the arrangement of text and chapters, and all sorts of very fine philological metrics. Meaning philology, the study of the history of language and words and characters. Chinese philology is like a very heavy study. Actually, that was what my friend got into from high school, who became later a professor of Chinese studies. Very intricate, but it just supports what I had sensed, which some people sense, which is that the writers of chapters 8 through 32 are not the same as the writer of chapters 1 through 7. So what I want to do is go into this foreword from Donald Monroe and go over his conclusions, his summary of the conclusions from the two scholars, Liu Xiaogan and Angus Graham. His write-up of a foreword, of a translation of one of those scholars putting together with the other scholar, their basic conclusions about who the heck did write the latter chapters, and is there some proof of that or evidence? There's a lot of evidence. And in many cases, human scholars just sort of prove or give strong evidence for various matters that one could intuit without such research. One doesn't need research to know many things. That doesn't mean research is useless. It's very helpful. But at best, we may know what they later have concluded in a long analytical, scholarly study. And so the question has been going on for a long time. Are those later chapters the same as the first seven? And both these scholars, Graham and Xiaogan, basically came to the conclusion that yes, the inner chapters were written by somebody different than the later. And it's very was really quite clear to me, and I felt a bit of repulsion actually reading chapters 8 and ongoing, where it really was clear to me, my feeling was that these are guys using similar style of metaphor, style of language, didactic style, that was copying and adding into and modifying and sort of piggybacking on and in a certain way exploiting actually the first seven chapters. And that's similar to what these guys found, these scholars too. And so in from Donald Munro's foreword to the book, talking about Liu Xiaogan and his intentions, he said, the crux of the question is, are there any objective differences between the inner chapters and the outer and miscellaneous chapters? And can these objective distinctions be used to ascertain chronological relationship? Yeah, the answer is yes. And Liu Xiaogan did that, and Angus Graham did that, and Munro is summarizing. And without getting into the very complex methods they used, basically looking at the usage of particular classical Chinese characters, single character technical terms appear or not appearing in compounds, like that. Very, very complicated, but very logical, deep analysis of the words and or the characters and their usage and the arrangement of the chapters. And the conclusions are very interesting, actually. And that's what starts on page X or 10 of the foreword from Munro. And that's page 11 of the PDF. And I will go through them. What we'd also see here are a couple of other things that are very useful. This is not just the study of classifying Zhuangzi chapters. It's also a reflection of the way human scholars and writers and sects and organize and religions have treated fundamental doctrine or original scripture. We can see what happened to the New Testament or the Gospels over the centuries. We can see the splits in Buddhism. We can see all sorts of people coming in later, reworking the founder's original writing or teaching, and it changing quite radically, you know? So from Gautama and the monks in India 2,500 years ago, being strictly celibate and being immediately thrown out of the Sangha if there's some major sexual activity or significant sexual activity, which is, you know, because Gautama is basically saying that's not that doesn't suffice, that doesn't conduce to nirvana, nibbana, or full attainment release in this lifetime if you get involved in all that. Meanwhile, later, Buddhism, you go all the way to Lamaism in Tibet or Japan, where monks get married, and then they do in Tibet or the esoteric traditions visualization of ritual sexual practice with imagined visualized deities. This is pretty far from the original. And whether it's good or bad is not matter, is another matter. But what is the case with the Zhuangzi? And I think it's quite similar to what happened with the Gospels. And you see it in every single religion, is that later people come in and freely add and delete text and ideas and perspectives because they want to make their mark. And they are part of some organization. They're part of opposing schools or the same school or the same school that split and modified over the centuries. And they don't really respect the original text, and they add to it and say, this is the original. Meanwhile, they just made it up 300 years later, 200 years later, 1,000 years later. So there's a certain chronic dishonesty here, and you see it everywhere. I see it everywhere. Doesn't mean everybody's dishonest, but a certain kind of dishonesty, intellectual dishonesty, has been with this group of 3D souls since the beginning, it seems, and still today, obviously. So people rightly can pick and choose and say, well, I don't agree with this, but at least this is the original teaching that I don't want to edit and modify. The original is the original, and then let's talk about what we think of it or how we understand it. That's cool. But it's like going into the raw material and then making it easy, and then 100 years later, people forgot the original, and all they find is the easy versions, meaning the language has been simplified. And it has nothing to do with the original voice, and much of it has been altered. And then people think, oh, that's the raw material. Wow, sounds like me. So like the website Fake Buddha Quotes, hundreds, it seems, of quotes that are modified, that are not original statements of Gautama, but later translations reworked and re-edited. And then people freely on Facebook or here or there post and say, oh, look what the Buddha said. You know, things that are actually, he didn't say whatsoever. There are hundreds of them, fake Buddha quotes. So there's fake Zhuangzi chapters. And some of their ideas are the same as for the first seven. Some of them are subtly different, but the language really is different and can be analyzed philologically to reveal that indeed there were multiple editions of multiple compilers or reworkers that were associated with other schools, not even just Taoism. So, then, page 11 of the PDF, which is page X, the Roman numeral of the foreword from Donald Monroe. I'm just going to read some, and you'll see how complicated things got. Donald Monroe wrote, applying these methods, meaning all the scholarly analysis tools, applying these methods throughout Liu, meaning Liu Shaogan, comes to the following conclusions. The seven inner chapters are mid-warring states period. And that is about 403, 450 to 222 BC. So warring states period is about 2,300 years ago. 2,400, 2,300, 2,200, about 2,300 years ago. So the seven inner chapters are mid-warring states period. They share sufficient vocabulary, style, and thought to constitute a single body or complete unit. Within them, within the seven, there appears to be development of Zhuangzi's thought from minimal disdain for the world to seeking complete transcendence from it. Aha. And so there appears to be a development of his thought in the first seven chapters. And the first seven can be therefore called Zhuangzi, and the later seven not quite. But it is just that is an interesting point. Minimal disdain for the world to seeking complete transcendence from it. That's a progression that we may be familiar with. First, we feel some disdain for humanity, for basically the ignorance. You know, many people are decent, but when it comes to knowledge or their view or the common consensus opinions about things, we may well feel some disdain. Then, two, seeking complete transcendence from it. Mm-hmm, that's how it evolves commonly. He goes on, the outer and miscellaneous chapters, meaning eight till the end, were completed by the last years of the Warring States period, before 235 BC, when Lu Buwei died. To argue for a compilation date before the final Qin conquest goes against prevailing opinion, dot, dot, dot. And so Liu Shaogan concludes that all of the outer and miscellaneous chapters were written by followers of Zhuangzi. And that's exactly what it seemed to me, that the first seven chapters were written by he himself, and the later 25 or so were written by followers, some of whom had allegiance to other schools that were even more political and not quite that spiritual transcendent or seeking transcendence or doing practice. And he said, they are not a melange of materials from disparate Taoist schools, meaning there were multiple Taoist schools, However, these additional chapters do divide according to three schools of Zhuangzi's followers. So then the Zhuangzi schools divided, or there were multiple schools. Clarity about terminology is important. Zhuangzi had followers, but there's no evidence presented about an organized school continuing after his death. And so that also is kind of interesting that he didn't, there wasn't a particularly organized school there. So then you've got Liu Shaogan and Angus Graham talking about the types of schools and traditions, the split in the Zhuangzi followers in the next few centuries. So one of them, they write, one of the groups of followers is the transmitters or expositors who live nearest in time to Zhuangzi and whose thought most closely resembles that of the inner chapters. Liu calls them transmitter school. And you see that in chapter 17 or 17 to 32. And Angus Graham talks about school of Zhuangzi. So you've got one feed being those that love Zhuangzi, and then rather than study, you know, rather than just study what he wrote and practice, they added more. And rather than make their own, they said it was his. Mm-hmm. That's very common in Chinese scholarship, that something, and Tibetan, and it's probably done all over the place, to write something new, even if you love your teacher, and say, he said it. To me, that's so incredibly disrespectful, but this is 3D Earth. Then the second set of chapters is writings left by those of Zhuangzi's later followers who adopted Huang Lao teachings. Huang Lao is Zhuangzi, and I think it's Lao Chang, but those who adopted, who brought in teachings from the Tao Te Ching. And that became popular in the late Warring States period, so, you know, 2200 years ago or something. Liu calls these the Huang Lao School, a telltale mark of the late Warring States, meaning, again, about 200 BC, 222, is the attempt to draw strength through comprehensiveness. Thus, the Huang Lao writers, the second group that added even more, synthesize Confucian, Taoist, and legalist ideas. So their view was, we honor our teacher by by showing how our school absorbs and includes all the best from every other school, too. You don't need those schools. Our school includes all that, too. Also, totally, I mean, if you want to say it directly, go ahead. But to say that this is what the founder said, it's his writing, it's his book, and that was done by somebody else who compiled it 2,200 years ago or so. To do that seems real dishonest to me. So they revere the arts of the Yellow Emperor and Lao Tzu. And somebody wrote Sima Tan. They selected the good parts of Confucianism and Moism from Mo Tzu, gathered the essentials of the school of names and the legalists. These chapters discuss human nature, social rank or divisions, and inaction, Wu Wei, and treat heaven as equal to Tao or even superior to Tao. And that's completely different than the original Lao Tzu, Tao Te Ching, and the first seven chapters of Zhuangzi, where, you know, there's nothing higher than Tao, and heaven and earth are created by Tao, or Tao Te. And that's heaven meaning non-physical dimensions, or higher dimensions, and earth meaning physical earth and third density space-time. That's very clean. Obviously, to say that heaven, meaning higher dimensions, is higher than Tao, superior to it, is completely distorted. If heaven and earth are created by, heaven and earth as part of the 10,000 things are created by Tao, how could it be higher than Tao? Higher meaning prior to. Of course not. So they don't think that. But they were coming from a place where, in some of the other traditions that they pulled from, ten or heaven was considered the top. So, there's also this term Tian Dao, meaning heaven Dao. This again came later and was not original in the first seven chapters, and nor really fitting, actually, Lao Tzu. So it's very interesting, for political purpose, for gaining followers and recognition, to gain power in society. They assimilated some of teachings of the other schools, Confucianism, Maoism, School of Names, and the legalists. And you see that in those later chapters. You see all sorts of confusion, actually, and fakery, it seems to me, and a synthesis that is not of the first seven chapters. So then, and in Graham, he called them syncretists. So they're syncretic, meaning synthetic. Syncretic is synthetic, is to put together. Then Munro goes on. Liu's classification, Liu Shaogan, his classification system highlights some ideas in these outer and miscellaneous chapters that are not found in the inner chapters. And so these are the fake Zhuangzi quotes, we can say. Fake Buddha quotes. There's fake Zhuangzi quotes in those chapters, starting from eight to the end. For example, where the inner chapters, 1 through 7, reveal no political interest, those of the Huang Lao school advocate non-action, Wu Wei, by rulers and zealous action by ministers. What? That is not of the first seven chapters. Zealous action by ministers. On this point, they converge with legalist writings. Oh my. So legalism is basically right-wing authoritarianism. It's basically the ruler must, treat everybody like straw dogs. That was in Lao Tzu, Tao Te Ching. But there's some a harshness. Legalism means everybody must be subordinate to the rules of the laws of the state. And this legalism was very well appreciated by communists and dictatorial emperors. And so that's put into Zhuangzi. He goes on, where the Zhuangzi of the inner chapters repudiates, meaning rejects, Confucian virtues such as benevolence, goodwill, and doing what is proper, right? All this discussion of when benevolence and righteousness came into society, real De or Tao De was lost, meaning a fake or for public consumption pseudo benevolence and righteousness and coordination or compliance with rites and rituals. So where the inner chapters repudiates that, the Huang Lao chapters, later chapters, are tolerant of them. Meanwhile, the Huang Lao authors subscribe to certain important ideas in the inner chapters, right? And so they try to take teachings from the inner chapters and mix them in with a what appears to me to be a melange or a composite synthesis, syncretism of ideas from other schools. For what? For political gain? For personal career advancement? I don't know. So these include meaning certain ideas from the inner that are taken to those outer chapters include forgetting one's bodily identity to join in great unity with the boundless, right? Leap into the boundless and make it your home. Well, how can you leap into the boundless and make it your home while you also advocate zealous action by ministers? So it depends on who, but the contradictions between the original teaching, the vision, the attainment, because the inner chapters are not just ideas, there are expressions of attainment of a guy or seems like one fellow. Those ideas come from presumably an attainment of Zhuangzi. That attainment is what is really on offer, on display, or available. What's really being given by any spiritual teaching, actually, is the attainment of the mind of the founder or the speaker. Their attainment, their vision, the relative expansion of their awareness, their relative freedom, moksha, their relative degree of freedom from ignorance, freedom from bondage, freedom from contradiction or conflict. It's their attainment of freedom and awareness and wisdom and peace, how far they've gone on the path, that comes out through those ideas, that is the heart of those ideas, and the attainment of the later writers who put together later chapters clearly was less. And so meanwhile, they mimic some of those inner chapters' ideas, but they don't have the same attainment. Then, the third group of chapters Liu Shaogan assigns to the school of no sovereign, or the anarchists. They consider hearing and sight, discuss the essentials of inborn nature, Xing, in opposing benevolence, propriety, ritual, and ceremony, right? The calcified pseudo-virtues of some people's usage of Confucianism. They differ from some of the more tolerant chapters, early other chapters. They long for a time prior to the emergence of civilizing arts. so then you've got something called a primitivist group and a Yangist group, a non-Taoist set containing the ideas of Yang Zhu. And so that's from Graham. And so you've got all sorts of influences that came in later. And you've got anarchists, you've got legalists, you've got those that appreciate Confucianism, those that are devotees of the Yellow Emperor. Huang actually is Huang Di, I think, or Huang means yellow. So the Yellow Emperor sect was distinct from Confucianism. And all these different groups split. And this was the time of the 100 schools, actually, or after that. 100 philosophers. In the Burton Watson write-up of Chuang-Tzu, there's a period of 100 philosophers, 551 to 233 BC. And so that's like, as I said, you've got some great philosophers in Greece and that Mediterranean zone. You've got Gautama and the Jainist school starting up about 500 BC in India. You've got these 100 philosophers, including Confucius and Mozi and Lao Tzu, and then later Zhuangzi and Han Feizi and Hui Shi and Shangyang, all these guys, also in the several centuries between 500 AD, BC, and zero. So this school period of 100 philosophers comes nicely in with the heyday of classical Greek philosophy. So Monroe says, Angus Graham, one of these two guys analyzing the chapters, differs from Liu Shaogan in holding that the inner chapters are mutilated and it is possible to repair them with scraps from other chapters. Liu finds no justification for this. And so Liu treats all outer and miscellaneous chapters as Taoist and written by followers of Zhuangzi. Graham maintains that while some are Taoist, there are, in addition, three other classes of writings divided by topical differences. So the short of that is both of these guys agree that there is solid logical textual basis for the seven chapters being the only originals. And whether they were modified themselves or not is of disagreement. So Graham even talks about the three other classes, and the second are non-Taoist. And frankly, I think that seems to be the case. meaning some of the people who were writing in those later chapters didn't really, believe or follow or take to heart the teachings of the first seven chapters. So that's great. So in all these different religions, you've got some people who are not only changing the founder's words and calling them the founders, but being the one who brings it to the public, but actually don't agree with all that the founder wrote or said or that perspective. Meanwhile, so they're putting in perspectives that would be antithetical to some degree with what the founder believed and spoke or taught, and calling them of the founder. It's like me saying that Gautama said, "Do your own thing, man." I mean, fake Buddha quotes, making something up because you like it, and saying, "My teacher said This is a really shocking to me. The lack of respect is breathtaking. It is very serious to me. And you can just see how humanity degenerates intellectually and morally. If even these guys 2,000 years ago were putting words into the mouth of the founder, while they themselves don't even agree with everything he wrote and correct it or modify it, and these are religionists or spiritualists or philosophers who are trying to help humanity or help themselves, presumably. Such amorality or immorality doesn't bode well for the future, and so that's what we see today. So then, Graham has another class that are not fully Taoist. They're called syncretist, which lays out a political philosophy in which the way of heaven and earth provides guidelines for government. Again, that's not at all the mode in the first seven chapters. These chapters reflect many hands, can be considered the ideas of a school. I mean, he thinks that they're that cohesive, that they're not, they're of a separate school. So, I don't need to get into all the details, but what you can see is what I've described, that there's some real problems. And so there's another discussion that starts on page X1V, XIV, meaning 14 of the foreword, or the preface, the foreword here. Said, there's a description by Sima Tan of what the Taoists, meaning the follower, the modified followers, Huang Lao, meaning emperor, yellow emperor, and Lao Tzu followers, what they believed. Everybody's splitting up, Liu takes this as the most authentic existing standard for categorizing something of the Warring States period as Taoist or Huang Lao. So, Taoism teaches people to be in spiritual concentration, moving in accordance with the formless, keeping tranquil, and spreading it over all things. So again, this is one guy's translation of one guy's write-up, Sima Tan, of his take of the Taoists of that time. The art of Taoism is following the great concords of yin and yang, and then it said adopting the advantage of Confucianism and Maoism, dot dot dot. And the Confucians are different. They think a sovereign is the model and example for the whole world. Dot dot dot. So, I think it's is a little too much detail here, actually. What I really gonna have to do is what I want to do, don't have to, is not today, but in the future, go back to the earlier chapters and read some of the heart of it. Maybe I could even do that a bit today. So, if for anybody who's really looking for detail, this translation of Liu Shaogan's classification of the chapters is really very interesting. I'm not interested in that level of detail myself, or not too much. it just shows you how complicated these things get and how dishonest people have been throughout the centuries, actually. So let's go back to the original. And see something. What I think I'm doing, what I'm going to do is similar to what I did with Nityananda, which is now that basic analysis has been offered in the past, in the previous 20 classes or so, going through each of the first seven chapters mainly, I want to read them through and just offer a hearing of each of the chapters, and then some focus on the core teachings, meaning the guidance for conduct. And that'll be how we wrap up Chöngsö. That'll take another month or two. So, chapter one, for those who really love this, if you don't, probably you won't be here. Free and Easy Wandering, translated by Burton Watson. And again, this is what you can bank on, or this is, banks are completely corrupt, so I don't think that's a good analogy. I trust these seven chapters, and I hear a voice of 2,300 years ago, without the political syncretism and dishonesty of the followers. It's always that way. It's always that way. There, you have singular figures throughout history, succeeded by far inferior and mediocre followers, inevitably. Every case, it's pretty much always that way. The people around a great being are not of the stature of the great being. You had that with Gautama, you had that with Chöngsö here, you have that with Lao Tan, Lao Tzu, everywhere. So anyway, Free and Easy Wandering, chapter one. And I'll just read it through, and that might be about all we do today. In the northern darkness, there is a fish, and his name is Kun. The Kun is so huge, I don't know how many thousand li he measures. He changes and becomes a bird whose name is Peng. So there's a fish becoming a bird. The back of the Peng measures I don't know how many thousand li across, and when he rises and flies off, his wings are like clouds all over the sky. When the sea begins to move, this bird sets off for the southern darkness, which is the lake of heaven. The Universal Harmony document records various wonders, and it says, quote, "When the Peng journeys to the southern darkness, the waters are roiled for 3,000 li. He beats the whirlwind and rises 90,000 li, setting off on the six-month gale. Wavering heat, bits of dust, living things blown about by the wind, the sky looks very blue. Is that its real color, or is it because it's so far away and it has no end? When the bird looks down, all he sees is blue, too. If water is not piled up deep enough, it won't have the strength to bear up a big boat. Pour a cup of water into a hollow in the floor, and bits of trash will sail on it like boats. But set the cup there, and it will stick fast, for the water is too shallow and the boat too large. If wind is not piled up deep enough, it won't have the strength to bear up great wings. Therefore, when the Peng rises 90,000 li, he must have the wind under him like that. Only then can he mount on the back of the wind, shoulder the blue sky, and nothing can hinder or block him. Only then can he set his eyes to the south. The cicada and the little dove laugh at this, saying, when we make an effort and fly up, we can get as far as the elm or the sapanwood tree. But sometimes we don't make it and just fall to the ground. Now, how is anyone going to go 90,000 li to the south? If you go off to the green woods nearby, you can take along food for three meals and come back with your stomach as full as ever. If you're going 100 li, You must grind the grain the night before, and if you're going 1,000 li, you must start getting the provisions together 3 months in advance. What do these two creatures understand? Meaning the little dove and the cicada. Little understanding cannot come up to great understanding. The short-lived cannot come up to the long-lived. How do I know this is so? The morning mushroom knows nothing of twilight and dawn. The summer cicada knows nothing of spring and autumn. They are the short-lived. South of Chu, there is a caterpillar that counts 500 years as one spring and 500 years as one autumn. Long, long ago, there was a great rose that counted 8,000 years as one spring and 8,000 years as one autumn. They are the long-lived. Yet Peng Zi alone is famous today for having lived a long time, and everybody tries to ape him. Isn't it pitiful? Meaning those are long-lived, but the human idea of long-lived is far more contracted. Among the questions of Tang Te Chi, we find the same thing. In the bald and barren north, there is a dark sea, the Lake of Heaven. In it is a fish that is several thousand li across, and no one knows how long. His name is Kun. There's also a bird there named Peng. So this is the same story, except instead of Kun turning to Peng, it's two different creatures. So there's also the bird there named Peng, with a back like Mount Tai and wings like clouds filling the sky. He beats the whirlwind, leaps into the air, rises up 90,000 li, cutting through the clouds and the mist, shouldering the blue sky, and then he turns his eyes south and prepares to journey to the southern darkness. The little quail looks at him and laughs and says, "Where does he think he's going? I give a great leap and fly up, but I never get more than 10 or 12 yards before I come down fluttering among the weeds and brambles." And that's the best kind of flying anyway. Where does he think he's going? End quote. Such is the difference between big and little. Therefore, a man who has wisdom enough to fill one office effectively, good conduct enough to impress one community, virtue enough to please one ruler, or talent enough to be called into service in one state, has the same kind of self-pride as these little creatures. Song Rong Zi would certainly burst out laughing at such a man. The whole world could praise Song Rong Zi, and it wouldn't make him exert himself. The whole world could condemn him, and it wouldn't make him mope. He drew a clear line between the internal and the external, and recognized the boundaries of true glory and disgrace. But that was all. As far as the world went, he didn't fret and worry, but there was still ground he left unturned. Lietzi could ride the wind and go soaring around with cool and breezy skill, but after 15 days he came back to earth. As far as the search for good fortune went, he didn't fret and worry. He escaped the trouble of walking, but he still had to depend on something to get around. If he had only mounted on the truth of heaven and earth, ridden the changes of the six breaths, and thus wandered on through the boundless, then what would he have had to depend on? Therefore I say, the perfect man has no self, the holy man has no merit, the sage has no fame. Yao wanted to concede or cede the empire to Shu Yu. Quote, "When the sun and moon have already come out," he said, "it's a waste of light to go on burning the torches, isn't it? When the seasonal rains are falling, it's a waste of water to go on irrigating the fields. If you took the throne, the world would be well ordered. I go on occupying it, but all I can see are my failings. I beg to turn over the world to you." This is Yao, King Emperor, wishing to cede it to Shu Yu. But Shu Yu said, "You govern the world, and the world is already well governed. Now, if I take your place, will I be doing it for a name? But name is only the guest of reality. Will I be doing it so I can play the part of a guest? When the tailor bird builds her nest in the deep wood, she uses no more than one branch. When the mole drinks at the river, he takes no more than a bellyful. Go home and forget the matter, my lord. I have no use for the rulership of the world. Though the cook may not run his kitchen properly, the priest and the impersonator of the dead at the sacrifice do not leap over the wine casks and sacrificial stands and go take his place. So, though I may not be perfect, or you may not be perfect, I keep to what's mine, and you should keep to what's yours. Jian Wu said to Lian Shu, quote, I was listening to Jie Wu's talk, Jie Yu, big and nothing to back it up, going on and on without turning around. I was completely dumbfounded at his words. No more end than the Milky Way, wild and wide of the mark, never coming near human affairs. So this is a criticism of somebody's talk spoken to another fellow who asks then, what were his words like? And actually, this is an example of the little bird or the little fish or the little frog not appreciating what greatness is. So what were his words like? Asked Lian Shu. Quote, he said that there's a holy man living on faraway Gushi Mountain with skin like ice or snow and gentle and shy like a young girl. He doesn't eat the five grains but sucks the wind, drinks the dew, climbs up on the clouds and mist, rides a flying dragon, and wanders beyond the four seas. By concentrating his spirit, Shen, he can protect creatures from sickness and plague and make the harvest plentiful. I thought this was all insane and refused to believe it. Human, oh so human. You would, said Lian Shu. We can't expect a blind man to appreciate beautiful patterns or a deaf man to listen to bells and drums. And blindness or deafness are not confined to the body alone. The understanding has them, meaning understanding also has blindness and deafness possible. And as your words just now have shown, this man, with this virtue or de of his, is about to embrace the 10,000 things and roll them into one. Though the age calls for reform, why should he wear himself out over the affairs of the world? There is nothing that can harm this man. Though floodwaters pile up to the sky, he will not drown. Though a great drought melts metal and stone and scorches the earth and hills, he will not be burned. From his dust and leavings alone, you could mold a Yao or a Shun, great mythical kings and rulers. Why should he consent to bother about mere things? And that's, again, this movement towards a complete transcendence, but it's a certain radical detachment emotionally. And whether that's right or wrong, you got to figure it out yourself. And for each of us, it will be right and wrong. Or for each of us, we have our own sense of right and wrong regarding just how much detachment is fitting for us. Just how much transcendence of the human social. Just how much we are well settled in not bothering about mere things. Not wearing ourselves out over the affairs of the world. I'm not saying you should do this or that, obviously. Do whatever you feel is best, but be real honest. And if you keep trying to open a door and it doesn't open, probably you should look for another door. If you've made great efforts and things don't go as you wish, maybe that line of endeavor is no longer useful. And so, going on, a man of Song who sold ceremonial hats made a trip to Yu, but the Yu people cut their hair short and tattooed their bodies and had no use for such things. Yao brought order to the people of the world and directed the government of all within the seas. But he went to see the four masters of the faraway Gushi Mountain, Gushi Shan, and when he got home north of the Fun River, he was dazed and had forgotten his kingdom there. Oh, I have legs, said one. And so forgetting the affairs of the world is quite useful regularly. And yet, we need to be here too. Hui Zi said to Zhuangzi, quote, the king of Wei gave me some seeds of a huge gourd. I planted them, and when they grew up, the fruit was big enough to hold 5 piculs, a certain measure. I tried using it for a water container, but it was so heavy I couldn't lift it. I split it in half to make dippers, but they were so large and unwieldy that I couldn't dip them into anything. It's not that the gourds weren't fantastically big, but I decided they were of no use, and so I smashed them to pieces. Jiangsu said, "You certainly are dense when it comes to using big things." In Sung, there was a man who was skilled at making a salve to prevent chapped hands. And generation after generation, his family made a living by bleaching silk in water. A traveler heard about the salve and offered to buy the prescription for 100 measures of gold. The man called everyone to a family council and said, "For generations we've been bleaching silk. We've never made more than a few measures of gold," he said. "Now, if we sell our secret, we can make 100 measures in one morning. Let's let him have it." The traveler got the salve, introduced it to the king of Wu, who was having trouble with the state of Yu. The king put the man in charge of his troops, and that winter they fought a naval battle with the men of Yu and gave them a bad beating. A portion of the conquered territory was awarded to the man as a fief. The salve had the power to prevent chapped hands in either case, but one man used it to get a fief, while the other one never got beyond silk bleaching, because they used it in different ways. Now, you had a gourd big enough to hold 5 piculs. Why didn't you think of making it into a great tub, so that you could go floating around the rivers and lakes, instead of worrying because it was too big and unwieldy to dip into things? Obviously, you still have a lot of underbrush in your head. And so, again, thinking outside the box. But also, if we can't have it the way we want it, we may be able to want it the way we have it. So they say, this is Edo Roshi said this, Edo Roshi, the scandal and the mess of Daibosatsu Zendo and Zen Studies Society said, you can't always have what you want, but you can want what you have. True. We can't always have what we want, and yet indeed we can make peace with what we have and come to find the value of what we have. This is difficult because we're fixed on getting what we want, and it takes a whole piece of work to accept that we're not going to get what we want. Then it's another piece of work to find the value in what indeed we do have. I can't have what I want. I will accept that and grieve the loss of getting what I want and accept the pain of having what I have. But now let me see if I can find some value in the continuance of having what I have or being where I am or in this condition, not having what I want, but having what I have, being where I am. What value can I find value here? The value of loss, the gain of loss, the gain in value in the conditions of life that we may right now have associated with the loss of the ideal or what we strongly want. It's a piece of work to come to that. That peace or balance of appreciation of the actual while having grieved the loss of the ideal. So, the final stories here. Hui Zi said to Zhuangzi, "I have a big tree called a shu. Its trunk is too gnarled and bumpy to apply a measuring line to, its branches too bent and twisty to match up to a compass or square. You could stand it by the road, and no carpenter would look at it twice. Your words, too, are big and useless, and so everyone alike spurns them." So Huizu criticizing Zhuangzi, saying, I have a tree that nobody wants, and you're useless like this tree. So from the common perspective, trees are useful and valuable. They're valuable in accord with a certain usage. And when that usage is not possible, when the actual doesn't fit the ideal usage of that tree, then that tree is called useless. And then he's applying that to criticism of Zhuangzi, saying, "You too, Mr. Taoist, are big and useless, and nobody wants you because you talk shit, you talk fantasy." Meanwhile, Zhuangzi has the last word because it's his book, and says, "This is page 59 on Burton Watson PDF. Maybe you've never seen a wild cat or a weasel. It crouches down and hides, watching for something to come along. It leaps and races east and west, not hesitating to go high or low, until it falls into the trap and dies in the net. Then again, there's the yak, big as a cloud covering the sky. It certainly knows how to be big, though it doesn't know how to catch rats. Now you have this big tree, and you're distressed because it's useless. Why don't you plant it in Not Even Anything Village, or in the field of Broad and Boundless? Relax and do nothing by its side, or lie down for a free and easy sleep under it. Axes will never shorten its life. Nothing can ever harm it. If there's no use for it, how can it come to grief or pain?" The use of the useless, the value of the useless. We've got to, make some modifications to apply that practically, obviously. But this is a core kind of Taoist perspective. Leap into the boundless, make it your home, means in this body, in this world. Understand or consider what is the boundless. The boundless is not just after death or higher dimensional or the octave, out of the octave or something. There's a certain radical freedom, or at least there is absolute radical freedom available. That's the ideal. Our actual attainment is obviously not that, if you can be, somebody sent me an email about this morning, actually. I mean, I don't mean, people are upset when I repeat that I'm not fully enlightened. It just means that no matter what I know or say or how I modify my perspective in the moment, this seven chakra system is not perfected. I don't think that if you're not omniscient and if you're not omnipotent, omniscient, and omnipresent, you're not finished. Now, you may know that I is Tat Sat, I is such, and the deathless, intelligent infinity or boundless awareness is true nature. Sure. But we're also living in this world right now. And we also have emotional process, and we also have not full perfection attainment of the boundless now. But this original Taoist teaching, chapter one, includes or concludes actually the end of the chapter where what we just read here, these stories. Plant your apparently valueless tree that does indeed not fulfill your the ideal usage, your idea of the ideal, your sense of the ideal for the tree is not the case. Your ideal life, or our desires as ideals, are inevitably not completely fulfilled. That's the actual. And he's saying, now you have the big tree, you're distressed because it's useless. Now you have this life in front of you right now, and you're distressed because it's not ideal. Why don't you plant your life? Why don't you plant your mind? Why don't you open to the perspective or put your angst at the actual of your life or today or this moment into plant it in Not Even Anything Village, or in the field of Broad and Boundless, or relax and do nothing here now, or lie down for a free and easy sleep here in your actual. Can we do that? That's a piece of work. That's the work of being free of working, you can say. And there is a certain radical freedom in Zhuangzi, the first seven chapters only. My opinion, there's a radical freedom here. And he is not of his followers, who clearly had some moral failings and not his attainment. So, with that said, can we plant the life we have in front of us, or the situation which is difficult we're facing? Can we move that towards the broad and boundless? Do we even know what broad and boundless is? I would presume, obviously, it has a lot of faith. There's a lot of faith, and time will shift. And we have to make peace with not knowing the future, not attaining the ideal physical life that we might have thought, physical meaning circumstances. It's a great challenge. I can't say I've attained some radical freedom living in the encroaching tyranny of the present time, but there is a way of broad and boundless, a Tao of broad and boundless, and focused on the first seven chapters, I think we can get a taste of that. So next time I'm just going to go to chapter 2 and do similar to what I did today, and no more scholarly analysis. So I hope it was useful, kind of a change of gear class. Thank you very much for being here. I hope it was helpful. Take good care of yourselves, and good night.